morning, everyone. Would you stand as we begin with some worship? You may be seated. Welcome to FCC, and thank you so much for joining us this morning. If you're a first-time visitor, we want to welcome you and invite you to go out to the Welcome Center, and we have a little gift for you if you're interested. Some of our upcoming events we have is our men's ministry has a men's prayer breakfast on November 23rd, and that's at 8:30 to 10 a.m. in the Fellowship Hall. Please sign up for the 2025 Bible study for the men's ministry as well in the lobby. It's $5 for the book. Our senior ministry will be having a Thanksgiving dinner tomorrow in the Family Life Center gym at 11 a.m. Also, our church holiday dinner will be Sunday, December 8th, immediately following service, and we're asking that you bring a side dish or a dessert, please. For our offering time, we want to encourage you to give back to God what He has given to you. And you can give your tithe and offerings by any of the following ways: through website, text, mail, or by placing them in the offering box out in the lobby. Would you please stand as Abby Beck comes up to lead us and in our scripture and prayer?
Good morning, everybody. I got real tickled because they said that the theme for worship music this morning was going to be bluegrass. So I guess we're having a good old Appalachian worship service this morning. And I was thinking about how God is, He loves all cultures, and how we read about the culture back a long time ago, but that God loves us just as much today. Isn't it great that we get to come and worship Him just the same as the Israelites did a long time ago? It's just amazing to me how God is just not limited to time, and it's just really exciting about how one day we're going to all get to be together and praise Him and worship, and it's just such an exciting time to get to do that. But the scripture for today is John chapter 20, verses 30 through 31, and it says the purpose of John's gospel. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of His disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. Will you please pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much that we can come into your presence today, just the same as the Israelites did a long time ago. You are a God that is not limited by time or space. You are all-knowing, all-powerful, all-loving, and we just praise you, we adore you, we trust you, we love you. Jesus, thank you so much for the salvation that you provide for us. Thank you for every word you ever spoke, every step you ever took. Thank you for how you came to the misunderstood and the hurting. Holy Spirit, we ask for your presence to come into our service. We want to worship you in spirit and in truth, God. Holy Spirit, please come and speak through Ben. I pray that if there be anyone in here who is hurting or who needs healing today or who needs hope today, that they would know this is the time for them to get it. I pray for anyone who is grieving today. We pray for those who are hurt, who are sick, who are lonely. We pray for all the needs of anyone in here today. Please help us to praise you in a worthy manner. Please lift us above any distractions so we can praise your holy name in spirit and in truth. We love you, God. We praise you, we adore you, and we thank you for all things. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. this word of peace is mine.
Passage of scripture to us as we continue to worship, and it's out of Psalms 145 verses 3 through 5, and it says, "Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works."
Oh, Lord, my God,
Good morning, First Church. How are all of you today? It's so good to see all of you. We're really glad that you're here, and we're going to take just a minute to focus in on the story of Christ on the cross. As we gather, like every week, there is one major theme as we talk every single Sunday, and that is Jesus. And that is for a good reason, and that is because Jesus is the main thing. Jesus will always be the main thing, and that's any time that our church ever wanders from there, please come and tell us, because Jesus is the main thing to us. As over the past couple of days, we've been at SciComm with our youth group, and we've had a really great time. It was absolutely amazing just to see all the ministry that is going on all over the world in different ways. And while we were there, one of the main sermons that we heard on the Friday evening was just a real back-to-basics message of the gospel. And some of our youth were like, we were wondering what did you think of that? It was kind of more basic than we normally hear, and we're like, you know what? The more we can just go back to the simplicity of the gospel, the better. That is never a message that we need to get bored of. And the following morning, we went into the main worship service, and there was thousands of people in Rupp Arena singing out God's praise, taking communion together, and praising his name. We had Grundy Mountain Choir down there, and just people from all over the world worshiping in their own languages, in their own cultures, and in their own ways. And it was the most amazing thing to see. It was this little glimpse of what heaven is going to be like. Singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty for all eternity, never getting tired." We sang a song where we proclaimed, "Holy, holy, holy, and worthy, worthy, worthy," and just the goosebumps and that feeling of like praise, authentic, proper praise. And the thought of that feeling for eternity is just fantastic. And it was really just this little glimpse as we look forward to the time when we get to be joined again with Christ. Until that time, we are told to remember through this act of communion. And while we do that, one of the things that Paul tells us to do in 1 Corinthians is to reflect, to examine ourselves authentically, and get our heart posture in the right place. Make sure that we're not abusing the Lord's Supper, and make sure that we're doing this together in a good way. So what I encourage you to do, Kate is going to play a little bit of guitar, and what I want you to do is just think a little bit about your relationship with Christ, what Christ has done for you, the sacrifice that he went through for you, and just take a moment to reconnect. in Paul's letter to the Corinthian church. In the 11th chapter, he says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Please take and eat together. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Take and drink. "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Father, we are so grateful for your sacrifice. Lord, we're so grateful that we can gather together and partake in communion together. Lord, you are our King. You are our Lord. Lord, we are here for you. And Lord, as we move into a time when we get to hear your word preached, and Lord, we just are so excited to hear what you have to say. Lord, give us all ears to hear and what you have to say. And be with Ben as he preaches this message for us today. Amen.
Hello, First Church. Wow, you all sounded good right there. I like that. I like that. If you're visiting here with us for the first time, you're relatively new here, my name is Ben. I am the lead pastor here at FCC. Glad to have you with us this morning. Middle schoolers, we'll go ahead and dismiss the middle schoolers to go downstairs with Thomas. So middle school students, if you'd like to go downstairs and just kind of cover the same scripture, same topics, a little bit more of a conversational manner, you feel free to do that now. A handful of things that I want to make you aware of that we didn't talk about in announcements, but I want to make you aware of before I get into my message. Number one is the trailer and the help that we've been working with Greg Barker going down to the North Carolina area in their continued recovery efforts. From the hurricane. He's going to be leaving out here in the next week or so. Really right now what the most pressing need is, he's taking some equipment down there to help do some repair work. So if you have any interest in donating monetarily, giving anything to help with gas or equipment or supplies while they're down there, that would be most helpful. If you'd like to do that, you can just give here to the church, just in the memo line or in the note. Just let us know that it's going to North Carolina and we'll make sure that he gets that. Also want to let you guys know that for Christmas this year, Rosemary Littleton is going to be offering, she's doing the little ornaments, little picture ornaments, that if you guys would like to have a handmade ornament that you can put a picture of you and your family or your favorite person in your house, which in the case of my wife, it would be one of our dogs. You can put whatever picture you want to in there. Let us know if you want to email us, let Vicki know. She's doing these basically for donations just to help out the youth missions, things of that nature. And we're really thankful for her doing that and wanting to serve in that capacity. A couple things that some of you may have gotten on your way in. Each month we're going to be giving out these little rack cards here. It basically gives you just some basic information of the church. And then whatever bigger events that are taking place during the month. So you'll see on this one, our senior adult ministry Thanksgiving meal is coming up tomorrow. Men's ministry's got a prayer breakfast that's coming up. And then like some things that's coming up in December and stuff already. So we'll have these for you each week. Make sure you get these if you're, kind of like to have things in front of you, hanging on your refrigerator, something that is there. And then also for the month of December, wanted to take 2 weeks to be able to give these out. This is a season of surrender. That's what we're going to be going through in the Christmas season in December here at First Church. This is a monthly family devotional for you. So we're getting ready to wrap up the Gospel of John here, and then we're going to be next week. This kind of steps us through John chapter 1. The little devotions you can do with your family, gives you some introductions, give you some conversation starters. This also has an Advent Bible reading plan with it as well. So we have these. You can get those at any of the tables as you're going out I encourage you to take one of these for your family. Sit down, do these with your family through the Christmas season. We all can get lost in the hustle and bustle of Christmas and the holiday season, but I feel like there are things that we can do also very purposefully kind of to maybe combat that a little bit and just push the brakes just a little bit for a moment with our families during this time to remember exactly why we are celebrating the season that we're celebrating. So if you would like to pick one of those up, we've got several printed off back there on your way out. Please feel free to get one. Let's go to John. John chapter 20. I'm getting close and close to the end of the study that we've been on. This is week number 25 in the Gospel according to John. And this week we're going to be looking at a sermon titled Belief Thesis. Okay, Belief Thesis. What we're going to find is at the end of this chapter, you're going to see John. Does anybody ever remember, or maybe currently, if you have to write a thesis statement for a class? That's just like, no, don't, please don't mention that. You know, don't bring that back up. But you're basically having to write something or provide a statement as to why you're defending whatever position you've taken or giving more evidence for it or really just hammering home that point. And what we see is John will do that at the end of this chapter. So we're going to read the entirety of it. We're going to put a scripture structure up here on the screen for you. As we go through, you will see the structure as we read through. You're going to have verses 1 through 10, 11 through 18, 19 through 28. Verse 29 is going to kind of stand on its own. But then we're going to get to verses 30 and 31 as well. So this is going to remain up here on the board as we read through this entirety of the chapter together, so you can have a little bit of point of reference as to how this passage is divided up. So John chapter 20, beginning with verse 1. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping in to look, he saw the linen cloth lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloth lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. Verse 11. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she stood to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" And Mary went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. Verse 19. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors began being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. "As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. For if you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you withhold forgiveness from any, it is withheld." Now Thomas, one of the 12, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see his hands, the mark of the nails, and place my finger into the mark of the nails, and place my hand into his side, I will never believe." 8 days later, his disciples were inside again, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands, and put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe." And Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Verse 29, Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." And verse 30 says, "Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." Now, our key takeaway this morning from this sermon is going to look a little bit differently than other key takeaways that we've had in the past. It's actually going to be the end passage that we just read, 30 and 31. "But these are written." Everything that John had written up until this point, all the previous 19-plus chapters, "but these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name." Now, I want us to look at this passage, and I want to bring it about, maybe, and pull some things out of it in such a way to encourage you a little bit this morning. Have any of you ever just wished that God would speak to you? Just like, "God, something, even if it's something I don't want to hear or I don't like, God, I want to hear, I want to see, I want to know that it's you, I want to experience that it's you." And then we go, we covered shame last week and the comparison factor. And then when we don't feel like we've been hearing from God, or we read his word and it just doesn't come alive to us, or we pray and we feel like the moment that the words come out of our mouth, they fall to the floor, and we begin to sit and think, "Okay, what is wrong with me? I'm reading, studying, I'm praying, I'm trying to live right, I'm trying to love other people, I'm trying to be nice, I'm doing what I should be doing, but yet nothing in my life. But I look at this brother or sister in Christ, and man, they've got it all together. And things are just happening for them." It's like, "Oh, I wish my life were like that." Or we see someone on social media, it's like, "Look how put together they are." Yeah, with enough filters, all of us are put together. And with AI coming, I mean, if it ever gets the hand thing figured out in pictures, we're all in trouble. But we begin to question, "God, why are you not speaking to me? Why are you not revealing yourself? Why am I not experiencing this? Look at this person. Look what they're doing. See what's happening to them." I want to suggest to you this morning that perhaps it's not the fact that God isn't revealing things about himself. It may not be the fact that God isn't speaking to you. Maybe it's happening in such a way that you've just not recognized it. And here's what I want to say. It's a couple things out of this passage. Again, this is John 20. This is full of a lot of things. This has got a lot of information, a lot of details we could mine out of it. Some of them actually have split congregations, denominations, and different doctrinal and theological beliefs. But I want us to look from this passage to see how Jesus related to the people that we see in John's record here. So the first thing that I kind of want to draw your attention to is, what did Peter and the other disciple, you know, the one whom Jesus loved, by the way, who won the foot race to the tomb, just throwing that in there, he was dangerous when he was sprinting. We have Peter and the other disciple, John, who just happens to be writing this. They get to the tomb. John says, I get there first. I stoop in. I look. I don't see Jesus. But what does John see? Says he sees the linens. Okay, says when Peter gets there, Peter actually goes in. What does Peter see? Peter sees the linens also, right? So he goes, and they both go back. They have looked and seen an empty tomb with just linens lying there. Now, if we look at verse 12, when Mary looks inside the tomb, she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head, one at the feet. So we see Peter and John, they see the linens, and that becomes evidence for them. Mary looks inside and sees two angels. Side note, if Ben looks in, sees two angels, the narrator says, and when Ben wakes back up, right? She sees two angels. Again, same tomb, same place, different people. Then she goes out, and in verse 16, before that, she sees someone, and she thinks it's the gardener. She thinks it's the caretaker of the tomb, and she's like, sir, please, if you know where they have taken my Lord, please let me know, and I will go get him, and I will do this properly. Please let me know. And it says that Jesus spoke and said, Mary. It was in that instant when she heard her name in which she recognized the voice. She, by appearance, did not look and see that this was Jesus. There was something different. Whatever, we don't know, but we see that there was something different about Jesus in this encounter, that she did not recognize him until she heard his voice. I want to attach this a little bit with last week, just for a moment, because we talked about shame and Jesus paying the price for our shame on Calvary. The moment that shame was introduced was at the very beginning in Genesis. The moment when the sin took place, it said that Adam and Eve, when they disobeyed, they realized that they were naked and they covered themselves. And then it said when God came to visit with them in the cool of the day, as was the custom, they hid themselves. And God asked them, why are you hiding? And they said, well, we were ashamed. We were naked. We were ashamed. The first response that God has to this is he asked them a question. Who told you that? Who told you? What voice are you listening to? See, because it was the enemy's voice that introduced a concept, a deception in there. He convinced them that they were not something that they actually were. He said that if you eat of this fruit, then you're going to become like God. And he doesn't want that. You see, what he convinced them is that they were not in the likeness of God, when we know that he created them in his image. One of the most powerful forces of deception in our lives as a believer are the voices that echo in our minds that try to drown out the voice of truth, Jesus Christ. See, it's the voice of Jesus that no matter what the situation may look like, no matter what type of external things that we are facing, it's that voice of truth, whether it looks like Jesus, feels like Jesus, it's that voice that when we hear his voice, we recognize the truth of who he is. My dad passed away. My goodness, it's been over 30 years ago now. And it's so funny to me that I can still watch old VHS tape. VHS, they're things that used to be before DVDs. Okay, DVDs were something that they had before digital downloads. Okay, I'm old, okay? But I can play an old tape, and I could be in another room, and even 30-some years later, I hear my dad's voice, and I still recognize it. Don't ever think that you're too detached from the Savior to recognize the truth of his voice in your life. So we see that there is a revealing here in different ways that caused them to believe. So it was with Peter and John, it was, I see the empty tomb. I see the cloths. I see them folded. I see them at the head and the feet. I believe now. I didn't understand what he was saying until now. With Mary, it was hearing his voice that caused her to believe. And now a second element of Mary's experience here is in verse 17. Jesus said to her, do not cling to me or do not touch me. For I have not yet ascended to the Father, but I go to my brothers and tell them. Okay, so Mary most likely reached out to embrace him, to touch something. And Jesus said, don't do that. Don't do that. I've not ascended to my Father yet. Okay, so make note of that. Now let's look a little bit later in the story of Thomas. We see Jesus on two instances. Jesus just appears. Like he walks through walls. He just appears. He does something. He's messing with the disciples at this point, I think. Okay? Because it says the doors were locked because the disciples were afraid of the Jews. Why were they afraid of the Jews? Because they had just crucified their Lord. And it just says Jesus, like, boop, I'm here. Appears to him once. Thomas wasn't there. Jesus said, hey, go tell him. They go, they find him, they tell him. Thomas is like, I'm not going to believe it. 8 days later, Thomas is there. Jesus appears again. Thomas said that I'm going to have to touch the wounds in his hand. I'm going to have to put my hand in the side of the Savior that was pierced. Jesus comes, and he says to Thomas in verse 27, put your finger here and see my hands. And put out your hand and place it in my side. Do not disbelieve, but believe. Do you see what could be a possible contradiction here? Mary, don't touch me. And you know what? It was fine. Mary believed without touching him. Thomas, who gets a bad rap, by the way. I want to let you know that we call him Doubting Thomas. But let's understand something. Thomas's faith, I think, was probably stronger at this point than any of ours in here. Because Thomas willingly went to a land where he knew that he was probably most likely going to be martyred for his faith. And he endured a terrible death for what he believed. So I don't know about Doubting Thomas. But I know that Jesus recognized what Thomas needed to believe. You see, some of us in this room can look into an empty tomb and go, I've encountered Jesus because I've got the evidence I need. Some of us may need a little bit of something else, than looking in and seeing angels. Okay, I believe now. Moving out, some of us may need to hear the voice of our Savior and say, I believe now. Some of us may need to be told, you don't need to come any closer. Some of us may be told, come as close as you need to. You see, God has a history of speaking uniquely throughout the generations. God has a history of revealing himself and communicating his truth uniquely to men and women of God all throughout the ages. We see that at one point, God reveals himself to Gideon in the dew of the morning. We see that God reveals himself to Elijah in a cloud the size of a man's hand. We see God speak through donkeys in the Old Testament. We see God speak through roosters in the New Testament. We see these unique ways that God is speaking and communicating to us. But if you're constantly saying, I've got to be like this person or I've got to be like that person, you may very well be missing the way that God is communicating to you uniquely. I don't think in my life, I don't think that God is nearly as aloof at times as what I make him out to be. I think that I may just not be recognizing God speaking to me in my life. Some of you may remember some years ago, a gentleman that came into church here, his name was James Brown. Not, I feel good, James Brown, or living in America, James Brown. And I'm sorry, I apologize if you tried to watch that Tyson fight the other night. I was just thinking of Rocky there. Not that James Brown. But James taught me so much. James was a brand new believer, and we would be just driving down the road or we'd be fishing together. And I can't tell you how many times we wound up slowly onto the bank because he was running the trolling motor, and he would just forget. And he would just stop, and he would go. And I'm like, what? And he's like, would you just look at that tree? I'm like, yeah. He said, no, look at it. And I'm like, all right, it's a tree. It's an oak, if I'm not mistaken. He's like, no, you're not seeing it, man. I'm like, what are you talking about? He's like, look at that. God has blessed us with such a beautiful tree. God made that. And when I see things like that, it just reminds me of how God loves me and how he's created these things and how awesome he is. And I'm like, that's a tree. But he had this ability to look at things around him that I was taking for granted, that didn't cause me pause at all. And he would look at him and go, man, isn't God awesome? I'm like, yes. Why? What, you know? And he would just be like, man, look at this. And see, that has helped me to slow down and just begin to appreciate the things that God has surrounded me with. Go ahead and just for your introverts in here, don't worry. This is not an icebreaker role play kind of game. But I just want you to take just a second and look at the people around you. Hey, look, smile, wave, say hi. God has blessed us with amazing people in our lives. God has blessed us with amazing people in this church. God has blessed us with an amazing community. He's blessed us, and what we often do is we try to look at that person that's sitting next to us or who sits across the church from us, and the first thing we see is a Facebook post that we didn't agree with. Instead of looking to go, thank you, God, for the blessings that you've given me. You see, I'm not always convinced that God is aloof or that he is distant. I think sometimes I just may not be speaking the same language that he's speaking, trying to communicate with me. And I love how we see that in this passage. And John, we've got chapter 21 next week, and we've covered a little bit of 21. And when we did, I made the statement that chapter 21 is really like an epilogue. All right, it's truly like an epilogue to this book. It's not that it isn't important. It is. But John writes the very ending of his message just as he began the first John 1:1. In the beginning, the Word was with God, In the beginning, the Word was with God. The Word was God. So he's coming straight out and saying that Jesus Christ is God. And then we see 30 and 31, which says, now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. John, leading up to this final thesis statement, gives us a whole chapter of how God and Jesus in particular communicated to different people in different ways. And I hope that encourages your heart this morning that you don't always have to hear from God the same way that I do. You don't always have to experience God the same way that the person sitting next to you does. But it is about making sure that we are aware of his presence in our lives. And I believe throughout this entire gospel that we've been presented with three questions over and over and over again in different ways, but I think that we can boil them down to three different questions, and I want to use this as the in your life aspect of our message today. And I believe that the first question that we see is, what do we need to believe? What do we need to believe? And here's the simple answer to that. I believe that we need to believe that Jesus is the Christ and that he is the Son of God. Jesus is the Christ and he is the Son of God. I think that that's what John was challenging his writers or his readers at the moment of writing this. I believe he was challenging them with this question, and I believe that we're faced with the same challenge today. Of what do we need to believe? We need to believe that Jesus is the Christ, that he is the Messiah. He is the one that was prophesied about. And just a few prophecies and a few promises from the Old Testament that Jesus fulfilled is, I believe that we see him fulfilling these promises that come about in our lives. The things that we see echoed and for the foreknowledge and people going, this is what's going to be happening. This is what you're going to be seeing. I believe that we also have to answer the question of what does it mean to believe? We need to trust completely. So what do we need to believe? That Jesus is the Christ. He is the Son of God. What does it mean to believe? It means that we need to trust him completely in everything that he accomplished, in everything that he said, in everything that was prophesied about. When we begin to look at these promises, Genesis 3 starts us off in the very Garden of Eden, the moment that the deception took place, the promise is given that there will be a man that comes born of the seed of the woman, and he will bridge the gap. The rebellion, the sin that was introduced, he will atone for that. In Psalm chapter 2, we see where there is one coming who is going to take care of all injustices. He's going to remedy all of our sin and our rebellion. In Isaiah 53, we see where there is a promised one that is coming that is going to lay his perfection down and pay the price for our imperfection. And then in Daniel chapter 7, we see a prophecy that he is going to come and he is going to restore and save and rule over every nation, every tribe, and every tongue. And these are just a few of the Old Testament promises. What do we need to believe? We need to believe that Jesus is this Messiah. That's what John is telling us. The one that all of the prophets in the Old Testament talked about is Jesus Christ. And not only is he the Messiah come to save us, but he is the Son of God. And I challenge you, go back in the Old Testament. Like I said, I just listed off a handful here. It is full of promises. Because from Genesis 3 on, it points to Jesus Christ. There's a lot of messed up stories in there, yes. But it all points to Jesus Christ and Him being the Christ and the Son of God. And we need to believe that He is the fulfillment of those promises. And the third question that I think that you need to be consistently answering is, why? Why do we need to believe? Why do we need to believe? And I'm going to let John's gospel answer this question for us with a few passages. John chapter 1, verse 4. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. So John 1, 4, why do we need to believe? Because we need to believe that in Him was life, and the life was the light of men. He is the one that illuminates us. It's not our knowledge, it's not our understanding, it's not anything that we can reach out and obtain and gain this wisdom and insight into. If not for Jesus Christ, we are walking in spiritual darkness. Why do we need to believe? John 3:16. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have eternal life. Why do we need to believe in Jesus? Because it's only through Jesus Christ that we're going to experience eternal life in heaven with Him. It's not through our own works. It's not through our own understanding. It's not through our own efforts. It's only through Jesus. John chapter 5, verse 24. Truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears My word and believes Him who has sent Me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life. Again, this is the promise of eternity that we see only through believing, following, and surrendering our lives to Jesus Christ. John chapter 11, verses 25 and 26. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in Me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in Me shall never die. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? That it's in Jesus Christ. And then John 14:6. Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through Me. What do you need to believe? According to John, it's that Jesus is the Christ and that He is the Son of God. Why do we need to believe this? Because Jesus is the place. He is the one. He is the promise keeper. He's the fulfillment of our questions that we need to wrestle with. What does it mean to believe? What do we need to believe? And why do we believe it? And folks, it's a wonderful pleasure and such an honor for me to be able to stand up here Sunday after Sunday after Sunday and exposit God's Word for you and provide answers and to dive into this and really study myself. But the truth is this morning, I am not a necessity in your life to believe these things. Because I am not telling you anything other than what you can find for yourself in this book. So what is your belief thesis this morning? I'm going to ask the praise team, if they would, to come on up and join me. What is the statement in your life? What is that belief that we should be looking back to our life and saying, everything that you see when you see Me, everything you think about when you think about Me, what is my life pointing back to? Because that's what John does at the beginning. He says, Jesus is the Son of God. And at the very end of this chapter, he reiterates that and he says, all of this is done so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ and that he is the Son of God. Do you believe that this morning? Because the question that question's really important. Because if you do believe that he is the Christ and he is the Son of God and you've not surrendered your life to him, you've not given your heart over to the Lord, then you find yourself in a place of jeopardy from an eternal standpoint. And I think that if we would truly consider the weight and the gravity of what's on the line, there's nothing that we can experience, that we can have, that we can just encounter in this life. There's nothing that comes even close to a reward of an eternity in heaven with Jesus Christ. And if you're here this morning and you have surrendered your heart, you have given your life over to him, you are living for him, then the question becomes, what's the belief thesis in your life? What is your life pointing towards? Your relationships, your conversations, your daily life. What is the testimony of your life this morning? I want to give you an opportunity to respond to that today. Either situation, if you're here and you need to surrender to Jesus, or if you're here and maybe you've struggled with that belief. Maybe there's times that you've struggled with just belief, period. And there's that doubt that's crept in, that shame, that guilt, that sense of condemnation. We want to pray for you. We want to come alongside of you and join you in prayer this morning. So at this time, I'm going to ask the prayer team, if they would, to join me up front. And I'm going to ask the remainder of you, if you would, to stand this morning. Let's worship in our time of invitation to respond in our hearts. Amen. Amen. You can be seated for just a few moments if you would like. I'm going to ask Brooke Holly to come up here. She's going to make you aware of our giving tree this year, what we're going to be utilizing for that. Also, just want to remind everybody, next Saturday mid-morning after the men's breakfast here at about 10 o'clock on Saturday morning, we're going to be decorating the church for the season. So if you would like to, if you'd like to join us, come out and give a hand. We would appreciate any help. Brooke.
Good morning. As he said, I'm Brooke Holly. I am our missions leader here at First Church of Christ. And first of all, I just need to say a thank you because, as Thomas mentioned, we took a group of 20 kids from our church this past weekend to SICOM, which is Student International Conference on Missions. And we had 20 kids that went and several adults that went with us. And they got to actually see over 100 different missionaries around the world and get to interact with them, talk to them, pray for them. They got to do meal packing. We did worship with them. Just a truly great event. And it's honestly possible because of the giving of our church. And it makes it much easier for me to come into church this morning and tell Ben and a couple of our elders that I accidentally went over budget and still keep my position here. So I appreciate the giving of the church. And that's going to segue into my next thing, which is the giving tree. Every year, First Church does a giving tree. And traditionally, we pick an organization or a mission around either here in Grayson or around the world, and we actually put tags on a Christmas tree, and you can grab a tag, purchase what item that is, and bring it back into church. And this year is going to look a little differently. I have been in talking to the director of the Chapel House and the Friendship House here in Grayson, and while the residents there do have basic needs that we will also fill, one of the things that we wanted to do to make it a little bit more special for them this year is we are actually going to provide a shopping experience for the residents. A lot of them do not get the opportunity to shop for their kids, grandkids, even great-grandkids. So what we're asking our church to do this year for the Giving Tree is that you will financially support this event that we're going to have, obviously be in prayer for it, but any money that you are willing to donate, you can write a check to FCC Grayson in the memo line. You can put Giving Tree, and we'll have a team of shoppers that will go out, will shop for different items, and we will bring it back to the Friendship House and Chapel House on December 22nd, and we're going to actually allow these residents to come in and shop for free. Now, we're getting our kids involved with this. I've been talking with Mandy and Thomas, and one of the things that we're going to do with our kids is they're going to help these people shop. That way, if Grandma Pearl doesn't know what her 8-year-old great-granddaughter would like for Christmas, we will actually pair that resident with one of the kids that are that age, and they will get to shop for their loved ones. And what I need, obviously, is money, because that's what I do, is I ask for money from people, and you all are great about giving for that. The other thing that I need is some volunteers. This is going to take place both at the Chapel House and the Friendship House, so we're going to have two different stores set up. We're also going to do some light refreshments and things like that. But people that are willing to sign up, you can come see me at the welcome table and get signed up for it. We'll find a place for you. You can also ask Mandy if you have any questions because we're kind of working together on this. And then, of course, if you can donate. We will continue to put out reminders between now and that time because if you're like me, I have to be reminded multiple times to actually remember to do something. So we'll be in clear communication with that. As well. And like I said, if you have any questions, please come see me and I'll be more than happy to answer them for you. I'm going to dismiss in prayer and then we'll let you go. Pray with me. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for just the ability to come into this house and worship you freely and just learn more about you, Lord. I pray that we take the message that Ben brought to us and just help us to apply it to our daily lives and just help us be what you want us to be a light in this world and be a witness to others in our community. We love you and we thank you so much for your son. It's in your son's name I pray. Amen. Have a great day.
When I die, hallelujah, bye and bye.